Jesus is Lord. That's a very simple statement. Jesus is Lord. It's only three words. Jesus is Lord. It's only three small, easily understandable words. Jesus is Lord. But this one small, simple statement carries huge significance, because this became a statement that had the power to start and sustain a movement that researchers say started with Jesus and his followers and then reached 20 million followers 300 years later, 310 AD, before it was hijacked and then tamed by the Roman Empire. And it's more than just that. It's also the whole of theology boiled down into three words. So it's an incredibly dense theological statement, even though it's so simple. And also, which is what I want to talk about this morning, it should be right at the core of who we are. It's the truth that guides us and shapes us. But that statement, Jesus is Lord, the story doesn't start there. It starts much, much earlier, when God has he's taken his people and he's decided to give them a nation of their own and a whole lot of guidelines to go with that, so that they can fulfill their destiny, which is to be an example to all the other nations around of him, to reveal who God is to the whole world. So we need to remember that at this time there were many other people groups, and these people groups had numerous gods. They had the god of the river, the god of the mountain, the god of the sky, the sun, the moon, and the list kind of goes on. There were many, many gods at the time in the people groups around gods, where God's people were. So it's into this context that God speaks to his people and gives his guidelines to them and teaches them about how he wants them to live. And this is where we get the reading that I've got, which is from Deuteronomy. It's Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 to 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are at home and when you're away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand. Fix them as an emblem on your forehead and write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. So for a Hebrew, I think it's quite clear from what we've just read that there are no other gods. And in this context, you can't have the Lord as your God and have the God of the river as well. It completely narrows down everything to that one truth, that one statement: the Lord is God. And this is an important reality for us, because in that statement it's showing that there's no separation between what's spiritual and anything else. There's no separation between what God is interested in and anything else. There's no separation between what God wants lordship over and anything else. There's no separation between what God should have lordship over and anything else. So any follower of Jesus who declares that Jesus is Lord makes that declaration right in the middle of this context, right in the middle of this Hebrew understanding of God's sovereignty, that he's the only God, and that because of that he has a claim on our lives as our Lord. And Jesus is the fulfillment of God's promise to send a Messiah. So when we encounter Jesus and then submit to him as Lord, then we can't have any other gods or idols. And I think whilst we don't have obvious gods like the God of the river and the God of the moon, then, I mean, some people still worship the moon and nature, okay? But for us, it's not obvious. But we can and do sometimes easily, and possibly without realizing it, give over parts of our lives to idols and false gods. And an example of that today is consumerism, and it's perhaps the most subtle and insipid of them all. I don't want to talk about that today. That's another issue altogether. But if we think about the words of Jesus, I'm just going to find them now. Matthew 10:38. He says this: "And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me." So that's a really strong demand there that Jesus places on the importance of following him, of putting everything else aside and taking up a cross, a difficult way of life, and following him. And later on in chapter 13, he talks about three kingdom parables, and he says this, and they're all along the same lines: "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." So again, Jesus is saying this is something that you need to be prepared to get rid of absolutely everything else and invest everything in this one thing. Again, that's pretty strong stuff from Jesus. But I think it needs to be that way because Jesus understands our humanity, and he's echoing that passage that we looked at earlier in Deuteronomy there. He's calling us to align ourselves totally with him in every part of our life, not separating out the different aspects of our life. You know, that way of thinking, you know, separating things out, that comes from the influence of Greek and Roman thinking in our culture. And we need to be able to shift our thinking to a different perspective. The Hebrew one, the one that puts God at the centre. But more than that, it's like everything comes and goes from this place of God being at the centre, of Jesus being the Lord. It's a bit like a heart, you know, the blood, it all has to come into the heart, and it all has to then go out from the heart, but the heart is the centre of it all. That's where it finds its meaning and its purpose and gets all that it needs, but it has to go into the heart and come out of the heart. But it's never, ever, you know, separated from the heart in that sense. And when Jesus gets asked, you know, what's the greatest commandment? You know, what's the most important thing we need to be thinking about? In Matthew 22, verses 37 and 38, Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind. And he's pointing us back to this idea that for God to be God, he needs to be God of everything. He needs to be completely central in all that we think and all that we do. He's the Lord of every part of our life. And this is why the centrality of Jesus in our lives is so important. And it's why it needs to be something that we keep coming back to and reflecting on and putting at the heart of everything we are and everything we do. Because if we think about it, if Jesus isn't the Lord of everything, then what is? It's an interesting question. I don't have the answer. But if Jesus isn't Lord of absolutely everything in my life, if I'm not loving him with all my heart, soul and mind, then is there just a void where there should be that love for God? Or actually, am I giving that love to something else? Am I actually, whether I realise it or not, giving my love and worship to something else, to another god, an idol perhaps? And it's a really provocative question, but I think that it's the sort of question that we need to keep coming back to, and we need to keep looking at our lives and saying, okay Lord, have I allowed something to become more important than it should be? So I've been trying to process this and take it on board in my life, and I have to say it's not easy. But when I think about the alternatives, I don't really want to have to contemplate those. The idea of being lukewarm, I think it's in Revelation where Jesus spits the lukewarm church out of his mouth. I don't really want to be in a position where I get spat out by Jesus. So I think for me, and hopefully for you guys too, as followers of Jesus, that this is an important thing. So what can we do about it if we're wanting to do things differently, if we're wanting to keep Jesus right at the centre of everything that we do and the way we live our lives? Well, here's a good place to start, and it's not necessarily the only way. You may have another way, a better way, but this is just a suggestion. But the fact that we engage with it is probably the most important thing. Talk to God about it. I think we just need to be able to sit with Jesus and be honest about where we're at, and then to let him speak into that, to speak to us. And there are many ways you can do that too, but do it in a way that's familiar to you, that works for you. And if you've got absolutely no idea of how to start that process, then what I suggest is that you just talk to God about how you're feeling, and then perhaps pick up your Bible, turn to a gospel, start reading it, and allow Jesus that you read about there to speak to you about your situation. So let me pray. Jesus, you are Lord. And for us to make that statement, Lord, it means that we need to submit to your Lordship. And I'm sorry, Lord, we're sorry when we don't do that, when we put other things in the place of you. We make other things more important than you. And Lord, I want to ask that you would help us to go through a process of making sure that you are our one God, that you are totally central to all we think and all we do. Lord, would you show us areas where we put other things on the throne of our hearts and we need to take them off and reinstate you. Lord, although we probably won't do things like write on our doorposts and strap things to our hands and our foreheads, that there's a sense in which we do need to have constant reminders of the fact that you are Lord, because you are Lord of every minute of every day, and everywhere we go, and in the context of everything we do, whoever we meet, wherever we are, you are Lord. And we just ask that you would help us, Lord, to know how to keep that central truth, that huge truth that has changed history, that is a huge statement about your nature. Jesus is Lord. How can we keep that right at the forefront of our thinking and our daily activities? Lord, we just thank you that you are also forgiving and merciful and long-suffering. And Lord, we don't want to take advantage of that, but we are thankful for it. We just ask that you would just really pour out your Spirit upon us to help us in this. Amen. Oh, bless you guys. And have a wonderful time just living life with our Lord.